you know, we had somebody in our own group who was an expert on the subject, Sri Narayan Parikh, who is a member of Gitanjali and is from Calcutta, runs a firm called Bespoke Consulting. And along with his two partners, Sanjeev Sahu and Shagun Mittal, who are also there with us today, started this firm almost 10 years back. And he has been advising various institutions, largely banks, on their Basel rating, not just in India, but across other markets too. So we have Sri Narayan with us, who has a presentation. So the way we will run our program today is that we will make it absolutely interactive, which because this is a very complicated topic and we should all ask questions as much as possible at the same time when he's presenting, so that, you know, you don't let the presentation get over and then you ask questions. So the idea is to, you know, sort of, it's like a working session. It's more of a, I would say, a learning, a sort of a session for all of us. So let it take it easy. Every slide that Sri Narayan will present, we will have the right to ask a question. In order to ask a question, you just have to raise your hand, or you could write it on the chat. If you want to ask it, you raise your hand and I'll unmute you to ask that question. So let's follow that protocol. And I'm sure the next 1 hour will be quite, not just exciting, but quite knowledgeable for all of us. With that words, over to you, Sri Narayan. You can now share your screen and go ahead.
Is this presentation visible right now?
One moment, let me just see.
Is it visible?
Not yet. One sec, let me just see. Video. Huh? Now, can you share the screen? Just share the screen.
Yeah, it's just a minute. I'm just sharing the screen. Just a minute.
Just see.
Is presentation visible right now?
No, just let me see.
Indicators, the financial health indicator of India is far, far better than various countries. Then why the rating of India is inferior to BBB rating kind of thing? They have also raised the questions that what kind of fiscal stimulus should be given to a country like India, and debt profile we should have. And there were also questions on that, what could be the GST rate, 18% rate is a peak rate kind of thing. There is an imposition of 10 rupees on petrol prices kind of thing. So there were various discussions which were going in the group. And all this discussion were primarily in silos actually. So I thought that let me provide a complete 360 degree view to the members of this forum. So they will understand that rating is not dependent upon one indicator or one variable. It is a composite exercise which includes various variable, macro variable indicators, which includes quantitative and qualitative parameters. So the objective of this exercise is that provide a 360 degree view to all the members of Gitanjali platform and the guest who has joined this program actually today. So before moving ahead, I just wanted to put some disclaimer over here, that we have already provided the objective of this program and views expressed here. In our studies and the views expressed herein doesn't, because myself, Sanjeev, Sagun and I are primarily from a rating industry background. So the views expressed in here in primarily don't include the views of basically our present employer or past employers by any means. This has the sole objective of providing the knowledge transfer to the members of the Gitanjali platform. And all the information contained in this learning program were primarily taken from the public domain actually. So what is credit rating? Let us first understand what is a credit rating. A credit rating is an exercise where the quantitative and qualitative assessment of various parameters are being considered to provide what is the repayment capacity of a borrower. The borrower can be a corporate, that can be an insurance company, that can be a bank, that can be any entity. But for the sake of this presentation, we will be understanding that what are the borrowing capacity from a sovereign perspective, actually. So when we are talking about sovereign, the sovereign also consider, because when we are rating a sovereign entity, then there are various other risks which are being coming into the picture. And the first one is the primarily the transfer risk. Transfer is primarily that whether the country will allow us to do a foreign currency remittances or not. So there will be an exchange control on remittance, which is one part of it. If the country is allowing it, then primarily there lies the conversion risk. The conversion is primarily that what is the credibility and stability of the exchange rate regime in that country. Take example of India. India has got very vibrant FX market, but in spite of that fact, IMF, World Bank, and various multilateral development agencies, including rating agencies, consider is a managed float market, actually, where the RBI intervention is very frequent to manage the rates of in the market. So they are giving is a negative signal in terms of the FX market is concerned in India. So from the perspective of this presentation, we shall primarily focus on sovereign rating today. And when we are talking about sovereign rating, then we will talk about only from one perspective, long-term, long-term issuer rating of a sovereign entity. So our concentration will be to understand not issue specific rating, issuer rating of a sovereign from a long-term perspective. So before moving ahead, let me tell you that why this is important. Because a very strong entity, for example, is entity like Soviet Union, which was primarily being considered as a superpower in 1990s era, that has also failed in commitment after the perestroika in 1998. They have failed in their commitment to honor their foreign currency obligation, and that lead to a lot of crisis within the market. 1998 crisis has also led to the long-term capital management, failure of the long-term capital management, and that lead to a lot of crisis in the financial market. So the objective of this exercise, what we are doing is that to understand the repayment capacity of a country from various perspective, in the sense that whether they will be able to repay the principal and interest on time. So that is the entire objective of this exercise we will try to understand. So now this is primarily the rating. This is the long-term issuer credit rating categories which are primarily being given. So since all of us are from the financial services background, so I think all of us are understanding what is the meaning of AAA, AA, single A, triple B, and hence and so on and so forth. So AAA is the highest safety when it is being considered. Double A is little lower. A is further lower thing. So if you are going lower, it means that our chances of default or our chances of repayment of principal and interest is lower, actually. So that these rating symbols primarily signify is that what would be the repayment capacity of a borrower, actually. Now next is we have just link the credit rating symbol which are being provided by the various credit rating agencies. So if you see that the common framework is primarily AAA, AA, single A, triple B, double B, single B, triple C kind of thing. But there is a variability within that thing. When we are talking about this rating symbol, then rating agencies are also assigned plus and minuses also. So a plus sign denotes that it is little up from that rating, and a minus sign is that primarily little down. And there are chances of that if is a little variation in the financial health of the borrowing entity, it can be downgraded, actually. So let me rephrase once again that what a plus and minuses means. That plus denotes that there are fair chances that it can be upgraded, and a minus chances is primarily it can be downgraded to the another category. And within that thing, they are also providing the rating outlook, which is positive, negative, and stable. A positive means that there are chances of upgradation, and a negative means that there are chances of further downgrade if the financial health of that entity, borrowing entity, is being changed. Now we are moving to the quantitative parameters which are primarily being considered when we are rating a sovereign entity. So the parameters are primarily economic, government finance, external sector, monetary instruments, kind of thing. So I will not talk too much about it. I will just read out what are those parameters. Possibly we can go into details of those parameters when we actually evaluate this quantitative parameters from India's perspective and other countries which we are considered in today's learning program. So economic structure is primarily nominal GDP, GDP per capita, inflation, population, unemployment. Government finances are revenue, expenditure, fiscal deficit, government debt in comparison to GDP. External sectors are primarily related to the foreign exchange profile of the country, which includes various benchmark like notional effective exchange rate, real effective exchange rate, current deficit, foreign currency debt, foreign currency reserves, kind of thing. Monetary parameters include money supply, domestic credit, then money supply 1, 2, 3 kind of M1, M2, M3 kind of thing. Then various liquidity ratios and external vulnerability indicators, which we will be viewing going forward. Now I am coming to another part, which is primarily a scorecard model. So this is scorecard model we will try to understand from a bigger perspective, because this scorecard primarily provides that what kind of rating can be assigned. As we have seen that various parameters are being considered, so these parameters are being assigned various weightages, and those weightages are being given to each and every parameter. For example, if you are talking about fiscal deficit, the fiscal deficit is a very important parameter. Similarly, the debt to GDP is also important parameter. Current account deficit is also important parameter. So we can give higher weightages to these parameters. And if those are not important, but in spite of not important, those are significant and to be considered, we can give the lower weightages. So the way a corporate entity is being rated. For example, a manufacturing organization will primarily we look into the current ratios. We look into the debt service coverage ratio, interest service coverage ratio, various ratios. Similarly, we look into the various ratios from the macroeconomic perspective for the country. And these macroeconomic variables are primarily divided in the fiscal strength, external vulnerability strength, economic strength, monetary strength, and institutional strength, which are nothing but the qualitative parameters. So let me read out that when we are talking about fiscal strength, then it includes the primary deficit, revenue deficit, fiscal deficit, and various other parameters which are leading to the fiscal health of the country. When extra vulnerability strength are considered, then we are considering the current account balance, FDI to GDP, external debt, foreign exchange reserve, and one of the important parameter is net international investment position. So on economic strength side, we all know that what is GDP size, what is GDP growth, inflation, GDP per capita, unemployment, gross investment, and these parameters are being considered on an economic strength. And when we are talking about monetary strength, then it includes domestic credit to GDP, debt service ratio, money supply, banking sector strength. And when we are talking about qualitative strength, which includes institutional specific parameter, which includes infrastructure, digital adoption, workforce skill set, business dynamism. So what we can understand out of this thing is that the way a corporate is being rated, a sovereign entity is also being rated, giving various weight assigned to the each and every parameter, and those parameters are being evaluated. And over and above these parameters, which are being outlined here, there is a very, very, there is a one important parameter, which is called political risk. If you have assigned rates and put the numbers in the Excel sheet, then some numbers will be coming out of that scorecard model, which will help in assigning the rating to the country.
Ryan, there is a question from Anshul, and he's asking, does the blue and red color indicate different things?
Yes, I will just come to that thing. That is
a lot of parts of the presentation that you would like to discuss. So if you could move a little fast and come to the crux of the whole thing, that would be really nice.
No, Rakesh, this is very important, because this is the model which is being considered across all the job by all the dating agencies.
My friend says that if you can just stop and ask request for questions, then it will be more interactive. That's the whole point.
Fine, I'm okay with that. So the very important parameter over and above this indicator which has been mentioned here is the political risk. The political risk is not only related to the government stability, that includes the socioeconomic condition, investment profile, internal conflict, external conflict, corruption within the country, the military intervention within the politics, religious tension, law and order, ethnic tension, and so on and so forth. So I'm not sure whether there is a different scorecard for the political, but let me tell you this thing, that this is so, one of the important parameter that even after providing a rating of AAA, AA kind of thing to any entity, they can downgrade it by 2-3 notch if the political stability is not there in that country. And we are one of them. Unfortunately, we are one of them, because they have outlined that the various things which I have mentioned right now, the like religious tension, law and border, corruption, external conflict, internal conflict, which are very much prevalent in our country. So they are primarily giving us negative outlook on the political risk. So the political risk is over and above this indicator which we have outlined. And when we are mentioning the blue color and red color, the blue color signifies that these indicators are positive for India. And red signifies that these are primarily negative for India. So we have also put numbers. So before moving ahead, let me tell you that this exercise it is a very data-driven exercise. We have put all the data which we have mentioned over here on the fiscal, external vulnerability, economic, monetary, and institutional strength. We will be going through that. So the data source is primarily for the fiscal. We have considered the economic survey and expenditure budget. And for comparison between the countries, we have considered IMF data. On external vulnerability, we have considered economic survey and RBI annual report and IMF. Economics related to economic strength, we have considered the data from IMF and World Bank. And for institutional specific related issues, we have considered a WF Global Competitiveness report, which is being published by them. Now we are very close to the number.
There is a question from Rashik. Rashik, can
you
mute yourself and ask a question, please?
Yeah, I want to ask whether ease of doing business rating has any impact on the rating or so.
Yes. Any impact on? Yeah. Yes, Rashik, it is definitely there. We will be covering those things in the institutional specific parameters. So that will be the last part. So as I mentioned to you that the rating exercise includes quantitative parameters and qualitative parameters. So we will included all the parameters within this thing. And we have done that to make the audience understand that how this is being compared with the various countries. So what we have done that we have taken three countries in each group. The group A is primarily the very advanced countries, and those are evergreen AAA rated entities. Those are US, Germany, and Australia. And group B, we have specifically included China because of the reason that we are always comparing ourselves with China. And we have also included Japan and Israel, which are also single rated entity. And in the group C, we have considered India, we have considered Indonesia and we have considered Russia. We wanted to include various countries like Brazil, but unfortunately, because they are part of BRIC economies, and unfortunately, Brazil is being rated kind of thing. So that has not been included. So the objective of grouping this thing that we will be comparing the data of all three groups and see that where do we stand? What are the areas where we can improve upon in terms of improving the credit rating of our country? So now I am moving directly to the data related part. So when I'm moving to the data related part, let me tell all the members present here that you can ask me anything, because if you are not understanding this data, then possibly we will not be able to understand that how the rating is being assigned. So from here onward, what we are understanding is the rupee balance sheet of India. So rupee balance sheet is primarily composed of the revenue and expenditure profile of the central government and the debt profile. We will be understanding both the things. So let us understand the
Sorry, Srinarayan, you said rupee balance sheet, but what I see is the P&L. It's not a balance sheet.
So this is P&L primarily. So we will understand the P&L right now. And in next couple of slides, we will also see that what is the debt profile of the country.
Sure.
So this revenue expenditure is primarily is for the central government for the financial year 2019-20. So when we are talking about, let us understand the expenditure profile of our country. So the very first thing is the other expenses, which is 7.5 trillion. And within this 7.5 trillion, the major component is interest. The interest is 6.25 trillion, which is a drain on our resources. So we are eating 30% of our revenue through interest servicing as of right now. So let me put some data here that around 1 trillion rupee is primarily spent on PPF and NSS scheme, which is being popular scheme in India right now. Then we are in a highly high interest rate trajectory. Most of the bonds which are being issued by the government as of right now, those bonds have a maturity of something around original maturity of 15 years, and those have coupon of 8%. So the cost of the borrowing as of right now is average 8% as of right now, which is very high when we are comparing it with the advanced economies, because the economies which we have mentioned, US, that has got 30-40 basis points. Japan was primarily in the negative interest rate.
When you say 8%, this is in rupee terms or this is in dollar terms?
No, this is rupee. We are only talking about rupee right now. We will
And it can change based on depreciation, but tomorrow if our currency...
No. Rupee. This is only rupee. This has nothing to do with the foreign currency outgo as of right now. We are for the next three slides are primarily for the rupee exposure of India government. When we are talking about foreign currency exposure, we will be starting from the slide number 14 or 13. I will let you know that when we are going into the foreign currency profile of the country.
I think somebody was trying to ask a question. Please go ahead.
Fine. So that is one part of it. So the interest rate trajectory is very, very high. 8% is a very high number.
Sriram here. Sorry, can
I? Yeah.
Srinarayan, this is, this is domestic debt, is it?
Yeah,
or are there any rupee denominated foreign currency debt?
Yeah.
All domestic debt.
Yes, all domestic debt. And most of them are primarily the bonds. This is also including T-bills, but those are very minimal in numbers. So mostly these are bond. I would say that 85-90% are bond.
As you go through, can you also throw some light on how has the interest rate movement been of these bonds? Because now G-Sec is 640, 650, whatever.
So, Sriram, I think that these are primarily linked to the inflation thing. I will come to that thing when I will be talking about economic indicators. So, inflation is also linked, I will let you know that how can we reduce our interest rate actually. I can also come to that point at a later stage. But the point which I'm trying to make here is that interest is a big drain on our resources. Big drain. I will let you know that, let me put another number before the audience here, that this is 30% of our revenue. If you talk about not AAA, AA or single A rated company, which are peers for India, like Peru, Croatia, and various other countries, they are being compared with India, and their interest to revenue is only 8%, only 8%. So we are spending so much of money on interest servicing. Then next to the establishment expenses, where defense and paramilitary forces are being consuming major portion of it. Other departments are primarily, which are central government departments, which are consuming 1.44 trillion. When we are talking about central sector scheme, then it includes, let me read out some figures, that the central sector scheme is primarily subsidies, capital subsidies and revenue subsidies. Who is taking those subsidies? Let me tell you that agriculture, fertilizer and food is 1 trillion each. Every year they are consuming 1 trillion rupees. That is 1 lakh crore actually on the subsidies. The next one is the capital subsidies for road transport, 0.82 trillion. Railway is 0.67. Petroleum is 0.42 actually. So this subsidy is also a big drain on our resources. Now next is a centrally sponsored scheme, which is primarily transferred to the state, which is MNREGA, National Health Mission, National Education Mission, Prime Minister Awas Yojana, and various other scheme. Then there are finance commission grant or transfer which are being happened to the rural and local bodies. And other grants are primarily one time, 1 lakh crore has been given to the state, and some other grants are 50-60,000 crores kind of thing. So the total is 27 lakh crore or 27 trillion. The message which I am putting here is that this 27 trillion is almost fixed actually, because you can't change the expenditure profile of this country. Even the prime ministers, various prime ministers had made an attempt to decrease the expenditure, but considering the political scenario in the country, if you are taking the benefit of one particular class of citizen, then the opposition will always pull the leg of the government. So whichever government has come, they have not been able to reduce the interest expenditure. They have never been, because as I mentioned it to you, that PPF and NSS is eating 1 trillion rupees every year. See, I easily remember when one of the finance minister has wanted to change the pattern of PPF from exempt to exempt tax kind of thing. There was so much of hue and cry in the newspapers actually. So the message which I'm trying to give you is that this 27 trillion, you can't move an inch plus or minuses kind of thing. So these are fixed, and this fixed are primarily being considered from the revenue profile, where our revenue are limited. What are our revenue? Revenue is gross is only 21 trillion. Out of this, devolution to state is something around 6.5 trillion. So net tax revenue comes to the central government is only 15 trillion. And non-tax revenue are primarily in the form of dividend, which is being given by the PSU, PSU entities, PSU banks, including the RBI, which has given 1 or 1.5 trillion last year. And the capital receipt is primarily disinvestment. So within this constraint, if their revenue is 19 and their expenditure is 27, then they have no option but to borrow. So the borrowing is primarily 7.66 trillion, 7.5 trillion last year. And this has been highlighted with the red arrow, which signifies that this is the fiscal deficit of the country. As I mentioned you in the beginning, so this number should be compared with the 200 trillion, which is nothing but the 3.8% of the fiscal deficit which we are running right now. So the message which I am trying to give you is that here is very plain and simple, that our expenditure is fixed. Within that fixed expenditure, we have big constraint on the revenue side. So let me also give you a perspective that what is going to happen next year when we are talking about it, because next year we are seeing that there is a dip of 10% or 15% of revenue. So 15 trillion can be 13.5 kind of thing. You don't expect much of revenue from the dividend from the PSU, because RBI will also be not paying you those dividend. There are no disinvestment. So I see that primarily your gross receipt, which is primarily showing 19.3 to here, which can come down to 15 trillion. So against this 15 trillion, your expenses are 27 trillion. So you are running a 12 trillion straightforward deficit. 12 divided by 200, 6 is 6% fiscal deficit is plain and simple. So if you are adding the fiscal stimulus which is being given by the government, 2, 3, 4, you add those numbers.
There is a question from Vinay Saraf.
Yeah.
Vinay, please go ahead, unmute yourself and ask the question, please.
My question is that I'm hearing that now to finance the deficit, fiscal deficit, then printing of the notes.
Okay.
So where does it go in the balance sheet here in this, suppose there is a printing of the notes, then where does it factor?
So, this is nothing but this red or this is the printing of the notes. So the printing of notes is just nothing but the borrowing actually. So you are government and yes. you can frame the rules. You can ask your banks to subscribe to your papers. So you will increase the various SLR, CRR kind of thing, and you ask to subscribe them to your bonds. So this 7.6 is nothing but the printing of the notes actually.
Okay, thank you.
This is the printing of the notes actually. So the message is loud and clear to everyone on this platform is that government doesn't have flexibility. Because when we are talking on the platform that why we are putting 18% GST, why we have put imposed 10 rupees on petrol prices or thing, government doesn't have avenues on adding to their to the revenue side. So what is the solution? The solution, let us go to the next slide. Let us find some solution here that this graph is primarily showing that what is the revenue to GDP ratio and what is the expenditure to GDP ratio. These are primarily for the three different set of the countries which we were talking about. So the first category is including US, Germany, and Australia. Second is China, Israel, and Japan. And third is the India, Indonesia, and Russia.
Srinarayan, there was a question on the earlier slides from Arpit. Arpit, can you please ask a question?
Sure. Hi, Srinarayan. I have a question.
Yeah.
We are reading that government is going to borrow more, about 4 lakh crores. And now they have started announcing further measures on the expenditure side to tide the economy for COVID-19 related issues. Mm-hmm. So this 4 lakh crores of extra borrowing, the question that is floating is whether it is to take care of decreased revenue or whether it is to take care of the upcoming extra expenditures.
So let me explain you once again that as I mentioned to you that I'm repeating once again, your expenditure is 26.98 is 27 trillion. This is 1% or 2% or here or there. This is almost fixed. You can't touch upon. I'm giving you a very practical example. There are a lot of debate on the MGNREGA actually. A lot of debate on MGNREGA, why we are paying money on this thing. There are chances of rolling back this scheme, but you can't help it because if you are rolling back any scheme, then there is a lot of debate about this thing on the newspaper that you are a particular citizen, a class of citizen are being impacted actually. So the message is that 27 trillion is almost fixed. You can't touch upon even a single rupee out of this thing. So what we are doing is here that the revenue, we need to increase revenue. But during this difficult time, you can't increase revenue. You can't tax your people. So your revenue will also be downsized. So what we are seeing, the revenue at 19 trillion right now, that can be downsized because of the reason that there will be less profit, less trade. So GST, less GST collection, less income tax collection. There will not be a dividend from the PSUs or RBI kind of thing. So your revenue will also be impacted. So your borrowing will increase under the current circumstances. And if you are giving fiscal stimulus, your borrowing will further increase. Am I clear, please?
Yeah, thank you. Thanks.
Now, let us see that. Let us try to find out some solution on this slide, which we are showing it here. Let us see that the income levels of very, very advanced countries, US, Germany, and Australia. Germany is constantly maintaining 45 to 50% of revenue. Australia is primarily 45%, US is 35%, and US is 30%. China has made good progress. They have their revenue to GDP was around 18% in 2005, and they have moved very close to 30%. But unfortunately, India is in a trajectory of only 20%. They have not been able to increase their revenue. Look at the expenditure side. Expenditures are primarily same as the revenues are. What it means that a sovereign entity is not a profit making entity. That is a welfare state. So whatever we are earning, we are spending, or we are spending more than what we are earning actually. So the government is running fiscal deficit in terms of doing welfare of the country. So more we earn, more we spend on our citizen to improve their lifestyle. So the question is that, can we increase the revenue share of India? I would say that it is easier said than done, because of the simple reason that we are not a prosperous country. So we are primarily earning 20% of GDP as a revenue. If you are trying to increase the tax, people will not be able to pay tax, because we are still poor country. Our per capita income is only $8,000. And let me tell you that this $8,000 has been increased in last 5 or 10 years or 15 years. Before that, it was something around $3,000, $4,000 actually. If you are comparing to the very advanced economies, we are not a prosperous country. So we need to bring prosperity first, then we can increase the. Mm-hmm. Hello? Yeah, any question? Hello? So we need to increase the prosperity.
One question. Yeah. You mentioned about $8,000, but that is also on PPP. Would you please explain us there's always this confusion between the nominal per capita that one has and on a PPP basis.
So there are two, the GDP is being measured on the current prices and purchasing power parity. Those are economic concepts. I will take you those things when we are going into the economic indicators, those things. So I kept reserved those things at a later stage, but let us understand that we are just like Germany. We can't increase our revenues to 50%, because if you want to increase revenue 50%, we have to also increase the income level of India. Because if you are trying to increase the revenue burden on the citizens, then their income level should also increase actually. So that is the reason that I have mentioned the statement, it is easier said than done. So the prosperity, tax revenue, everything goes in hand in hand kind of thing. So it is good that we are the fifth largest economy in the world as of right now, but there is a long journey to complete in terms of if you want to come into the category of Germany, Australia, or US kind of thing. So that is the message which I am giving you.
Ravi ji has a question. Ravi Lalpuria. Ravi ji, please go ahead. Unmute yourself and ask the question. Can you? So I'll say his question. His question is that how revenue is 20% of GDP, it's only 12%.
Yes, that is right question. Actually, I was also thinking about it, because if you see that the gross tax to revenue is something around 11.5%, and next tax to revenue is something around 8% in India as of right now. So the numbers which is coming here is 20%, and this data has been being considered from the. So on a comparable basis, we have considered this data from IMF, and what is the difference between 11.5% and 20%? I'm still juggling about it. I will come back to you on those numbers at a later stage.
Thanks. Thanks.
So I know I will already analyze why they are taking 20% when the tax to gross tax is only 11.5%. So I could not find a credible answer to this thing. But I will come back to you definitely on this thing.
Is there a standard? Like, let's say if somebody asks you a question that what should be the normal revenue to GDP? What is the number which is right? Or what is the number which is an ideal number that one should target?
So let me find out the difference. But because let me tell you that when we are talking about tax, the tax includes indirect taxes and direct taxes both. The direct indirect is in our country is GST as of right now, and some portion of excise, and indirect and direct taxes is primarily corporate tax and individual tax. So these are the only tax structure. So when we are looking at the tax structure of all advanced countries, you will find in India the direct tax is 55%. Let me go to this slide. 11.70 is primarily 55% of your gross revenue, and indirect tax is primarily 45%. But this is the reverse in the advanced countries. Advanced countries primarily generating revenues through indirect tax medium, because as a general layman,
but the share of indirect taxes would be going up over the period of time, right?
Over the period, because it will take time.
Direct taxes, corporate taxes have come down. Mm-hmm. So share of direct taxes will further go down, right?
Definitely, no doubt. So we are making progress, but there are miles to go before we sleep. Actually, that is the language which I like to use. Actually, so there are miles to go to complete our journey to achieve what kind of economy which is being prevalent in US, Germany, Australia, or a very industrialized economy like Japan.
But so what is the ratio there? Let's say if I have to compare it with Germany or US that you mentioned. So what would be the ratio of indirect to direct taxes in those countries?
I don't remember, but that should indirect should not be less than 60% in my opinion. I will come back to you on those numbers, because indirect taxes are primarily higher in advanced economies. I don't have those numbers right now, but that is definitely on the higher side actually.
Yeah, sure.
Now I'm coming to the next course, which is also part of INR balance sheet of India. So INR balance sheet is primarily, the first is the fiscal deficit. We have spoken a lot about fiscal deficit, but I will like to make only one statement on the fiscal deficit data. The data is primarily, if you see it, that in 2009, if you can see my mouse actually here, this is 2009 actually. If you can see my mouse actually. So during this financial crisis, everyone has gone through a difficult period, and their fiscal deficit has increased, particularly from the Russia's point of view, because Russia has got a positive fiscal deficit of fiscal surplus of 10% to minus 9% kind of thing. So I will not talk too much about fiscal deficit. I think everyone of you have understood it. So if you have got any question, I will like to answer it. But I will move to the gross debt to GDP ratio, which is a very, very significant number. So what is this number is primarily, let us see that on US, Germany and Australia, Australia is fairly stable, below 50% of GDP is there. Domestic currency borrowing.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah, go ahead, please.
This is Ramakant Parikh, Chartered Accountant Ramakant Parikh from Mumbai.
Yeah.
I wanted to ask you, what is the ideal scenario? For example, if we read the Kotarli Arthashastra, we need that 25, taxes should not be more than 25%. When we come to our, when we see our balance sheet, our revenue side, we don't find any other source of income. See, such a large company, everywhere I find the energy, but we should have other resources also. Can you guide us from the world side, like other countries, how much other resources they are contributing, other revenues apart from taxes?
I think that the major portion is coming from taxes only, sir. There is no doubt about it that there are, because if you look at these numbers, which I'm repeating here once again, the non-tax revenue is 3.45, is nothing but you are taking dividend from the entities in which you are a major shareholder. And capital received is nothing but that disinvestment. So what you need to that, how can you increase it? You can only increase this number actually, this number. This 9.93 you can increase, you can put more commodities or more consumables in the tax net. You increase the rate also. Because when government is collecting tax, then they are not keeping that tax in their pocket. Their objective is not to make profit. They will primarily use that money for the welfare of their citizens. So considering a welfare entity, if they are increasing the revenue, their revenue will be primarily devoted towards our well-being. And that thing has been come out from these graphs which we are showing it to you. If you see it here on this thing, if Germany is collecting 45% of GDP as their tax, then they are also spending 45% of their GDP on their citizens. So higher tax is nothing wrong. Higher tax is primarily you collect the tax on behalf of your citizen and you put those taxes for the welfare of your citizens. I'm talking about the gross debt to the GDP ratio is nothing but the gross debt. Is there any question? Okay.
Kindly mute yourself if you don't have a question, guys.
So the exceptional number in this entire three graph is primarily Japan, which is primarily running 250% of their GDP as their gross debt. So let me tell you.
There's a question from Rasik sir. Rasik sir, you want to ask a question? Please go ahead.
So I'm moving ahead. We are running short of time, so let me move ahead. Actually, so the only exception in all three graphs are primarily Japan. Japan is primarily running 250%, exactly 238% actually. So 238% of their GDP is primarily in the debt as of right now. So it means that Japan has undergone a very painful phase from 1991 onwards. Because they were under the deflation pressure. So what they have done that they have tried to infuse liquidity within the market. They have given the loans to the various entities to create the demand, but that has not given the good result to them. But unfortunately, that has increased the debt within that country, and that is spiraling and going up to something around 230-240%, which is a very high number. So what is the implication of this 230%, 240%? Let me tell you that Japan has got something around 65% of GDP as their debt in the before 1990 crisis, actually 1991 crisis. So once they have gone into deflation mode, they started increasing the debt, and that is the single most important factor. A triple rated entity before 1991 has come to a level of a single rated entity as of right now. This is the single most important factor for Japan.
So, I have a question here. Yeah, please.
Who's this? I am Sandeep Kedia here, chartered accountant.
Yes.
See, if the borrowing, if Japan's borrowing is at negative interest rate, then will this not constitute a revenue item in their balance sheet?
So Sandeep, is a good question. So what I'm telling here is the balance sheet item, and what you have spoken is primarily P&L item. So there, if you have seen my earlier slide, then you can see it there. There is no deficit on the debt side because Japan is primarily a very low interest, 5 basis point, 10 basis point, 15 basis point, 20 basis point kind of interest rate. So the message which I have given to you that India's debt is fetching something around 8% interest rate, which is a big drain on our resources. But that is not happening for US, Euro countries. And Japan is in very advantageous stage because their interest rates were negative from 1992 to 2010 kind of thing. They started increasing in from last 7-8 years only. So they have not spent. So this is only increase on the balance sheet side, but the impact on P&L is very is minimal actually. So I'm moving from Indian rupee balance sheet to the primary foreign currency balance sheet of the government of India. Before moving to the foreign currency balance sheet, the various issues which is being floated in the group, that what kind of revenue things, what kind of
debt. Shrinarayan, just one small point that we are already 8:00, so we'll have to time ourselves a little better.
Yes. So yeah. I'm moving to the basically current account deficit. I will just skip this slide because let us understand from the numbers here actually. So because we are running short of time, we are running short of time. So if you see that the current account deficit is primarily arising out of the trade deficit. So when we are talking about trade deficit, the commodities imported and commodities exported. So we are net negative because of the major contributor is the petroleum and petroleum product. Last year, out of 500 billion import, 125 billion has been contribution from the petroleum side actually. So with the reduction in petroleum prices, I think that this going forward we will be positive. The other important parameters are primarily services, which is the service which is nothing but the service export. Income, I have not found out the what is the nomenclature. I understand this is primarily interest on the foreign currency borrowing. Remittances are primarily the NRIs and person of Indian origin who are residing out India, which are we are sending. So net, we are on the current account, we are negative. So negative is primarily being compensated through the FDI, FPI, and the borrowing which we are making. So if you see it over here, that I have put this number here in the red line box, it means that our current account deficit, which is primarily a P&L deficit, is being compensated by capital account deficit. It has got implication. What is the implication is that we will understand going forward that we need to repay this money actually. So now I wanted to show you this slide that whatever we have seen here. So the major contributor to the capital account deficit is primarily this yellow number, which is nothing but the trade deficit. This is being compensated by the brown number, which is nothing out of the software export. And this light blue color is primarily representing the remittances. So the whatever is deficit is coming account on the trade deficit is being compensated by the remittances and the software export. Now, another important point which I like to highlight here is that, which is very, very important, that the three biggest trading partner for India is China, US and UAE. We will exclude UAE because UAE had been in 2018, they have 17, they have been major partner, but 2018. So we will only compare US and China here. So US is net for us, US entity for we are giving net export to US, but China is big negative for India because of the simple reason that we are exporting only 15 billion and we are importing 75 billion. So 60 billion is negative on China's account. The message is loud and clear here is that China is not giving any material we can't manufacture. So when we are talking about that shifting of manufacturing basis from China, let us concentrate on then seeing that can we find the replacement of Chinese import or not. This is the message which is coming out of this thing. Let us not look at the future, look at the basically present. We are importing used materials, used consumables, which we can also manufacture in our country. Now, this is on capital account. This is on capital, this is balance sheet items on foreign currency. Our external debts are primarily in the range of half a trillion. GDP ratio is near to 20%. FX reserves to total debt is good number, very close to 80%. We have got use reserve in terms of export, which is 10 to 11 months kind of thing from last 2-3 years. So we are very, very comfortable on the foreign currency side. External debt is not very high and FX reserves are also good numbers. And we have got sufficient FX reserves to take care of import. Now, the biggest problem is coming out of the balance sheet actually, which is nothing but the net international investment position. What is the net international investment position is the balance sheet. Balance sheet is that whatever we are getting as a debt and borrowing borrowing and equity from foreign destination, those we need to repay. And those repayments should happen. So what we have done that we have only invested only 50% of those things we have invested in creating our reserve. Rest of 50% are primarily used for increasing the capital base in India. So although these numbers are negative, but rating agencies are fairly comfortable about this number, that these numbers are not very large. So let me put a summarized statement here, is that rating agency has already mentioned that they are very comfortable with the foreign currency positions of foreign currency balance sheet of India. There are no issues because India has learned from their 1991 mistakes, but domestic currency balance sheet is a big concern for them. Everything they are primarily putting on the negative side is on the domestic currency balance sheet, not on the foreign currency balance sheet. So these numbers are primarily, we can compare with Japan, Germany, China, and US. Because we are running short of time, otherwise I could have also told you that Japan, I will just like to mention one line here. Japan is very, very impressive performance. The only minus side, the impressive performance is that they have got largest NIP. They have got largest foreign currency surplus in the world, beyond China, beyond Germany also. But unfortunately, they have got very high domestic currency debt. That is the only single most important reason that a triple rated entity has been moved from a trajectory of triple A to a single A actually. Now, so we have completed the domestic currency, we have completed the foreign currency. Now I am moving to the economic indicators. So Sriram, I would like to answer your question here, that I put intentionally inflation on the top of everything, because if you look at the economies across the world, then they have got a target of inflation of 2%. They are very categorically mentioned in their budget that our target for next year inflation is not more than 2%, and they always maintain below 2%. But unfortunately, in India, we have been experiencing an inflation of 10%, 12% till 2000. So we have also completed a long journey to bring our inflation level to 4%. And we need, but there are miles to go. There are miles to go before we sleep. So this is also we have to complete. We have to also bring down this number substantially. So your question, Sriram, your question, I'm just answering your question, is that how can we reduce the interest rate? Unless and until we reduce the inflation, we can't reduce the interest rate, because interest rates are directly linked to the inflation. Because if the commodity prices are higher, your interest rate can't be lower than your inflation rate. It should always be more than inflation rate. So once we can control the interest rate, we can definitely bring down our interest rate. So there is a fundamental.
I understand. I mean, obviously, your real interest rate is interest rate minus inflation.
Yes.
The point is, even if I'm a 6%, 7% bank rate, it's only effectively 3%. But the point, you know, I just wanted to make a submission on the inflation part. See, developing countries will always have high rates of inflation. You cannot, because if India reaches a 1% or a 2% rate of inflation, you are a disaster. Because your growth will typically happen. Look at US. It has 1.5% inflation. It will grow at 3%. That's a great growth for them. If a country like us grows at 3%, I mean, you're dead. In fact, the entire agrarian distress of the last 5 years is because of low food inflation. We had a 1% food inflation for 5 years. Fantastic supply chain management. Everything great by the government. No question. The middle class is extremely happy. But the problem is, the farmer, I mean, 50% of our population is dependent on primary produce. Okay. So therefore, agricultural produce probably, you know, the producers of agricultural produce probably got a 1% increase year on year in terms of their revenue for their output, which is actually a very significant reason for a lot of problems in the rural areas that we see. So therefore, I think we have to live with a 4% inflation. A 2 to 3% food inflation is good for us, because that's what will probably feed a large population in terms of
this is definitely right, Sriram. But let me tell you that if we can maintain 3 to 4%, we can at least bring down our interest cost, which we have seen 30%, to something around 15 to 20% actually. So if we can bring down those numbers, so
that's fine. I'm just saying, but
Yes.
There is a, you know, there is a level beyond which it is injurious for developing countries to control
inflation. I completely agree. So gradually from 10% inflation, we have come down to 4%. So 20 years is a good period. So I'm not saying that 4% should decrease to 2% in 2025 actually. Let us target a 2035-40 kind of thing or 2030. 10 years is a good period to bring those down those inflation.
Yeah,
so which will also help because that will also bring down the cost of capital for an entrepreneur also. That will bring down the cost of the government also. You have seen that what kind of interest rates are being in the developing economies. I have also give you the example of BBB rated entities which are primarily managing 8% of revenue as an interest cost actually.
No. See, so okay. when your per capita income goes to, see, today your per capita income is $1,500 or $2,000 at best. Non PPP. I'm saying on real basis.
Correct.
Unless you move to $8,000 to $12,000, you can't imagine of a low inflation, low interest rate regime.
That's
a reality.
Right.
So many people have to move up. So that was my limited point. Thanks. Go ahead.
Just two minutes, I'm finishing the presentation. Then we can.
There will be lots of questions post that, huh? So that's why.
Yeah. So GDP size, we are very, very comfortable. We are fifth largest economy. GDP growth is not good because Moody's has raised concern that we have moved from a trajectory of 8% growth to the 4%. GDP per capita is a big concern. We have a large population, but China has also a large population. They have got 4 times or 5 times bigger numbers than us. Investment to GDP is a good number for us. Saving to GDP is also a good number for us. Unemployment are primarily big, but government is managing it right now. So now I'm coming to the last slide. Let me complete, then we can take questions because we are running short of time. So these are primarily, this is the last slide. This is primarily nothing but the qualitative parameters. When we are talking about the qualitative parameters, then we are talking about the institutional specific securities, social capital, transparency, infrastructure, digital adoption, workforce, business dynamism. And you will be surprised to know that there are 3-4 agencies which are compiling these reports. So if you think that these are primarily a mind-driven numbers, these are not mind-driven numbers. These are a proper exercise being taken, and every year those are being disclosed, and these are public figures. So I am giving you one example. If digital adoption in today's world, we are 120th country, then we are lagging behind. China is 18th.
What is 32 in that case, Srini?
So without bracket number is the score, and within the bracket is the ranking of the country actually. So this is the way it is being designed.
Okay.
So
32 and our rank is 120th. Okay.
Yeah. So our rank is 120th, and we are far behind. We have to go a long journey in terms of.
This number sounds quite odd actually, because the kind of digital adoption that we see in our lives,
That is not only urban population, Rakesh. We have to also consider the entire 130 crore population. So they are considering 130 crore population.
That's the problem. We'll come to that. Yes. Mm-hmm.
So what I'm telling you that this is another message which I'm telling you is that for example, that out of these 5 parameters, if rating agencies are finding that we are on 4 parameters, we are lagging behind. They have got every right to bring rating by 2 notches down. Actually, subjective parameters are very, very important. And they are also giving rationale in their rating that why they are bringing down on the qualitative parameters. They have also given the political risk, which I have told you that on number of occasions on African countries, they are mentioning that we are bringing down your rating only by 2 notches down because of the political risk. You have used corruption, you have used racial tension in your country, you have got not good relations with your neighbor, and so on and so forth. On qualitative parameters, they bring down the rating of a country a lot actually. So that is the message. So I'm through with my presentation, and I would like to take some questions from the audience regarding whatever we have presented.
Sure, I think, thank you so much. Srinarayan, and we'll now go to the participants. You can either type or you can raise your hand and I'll ask you, request you to ask a question. Please go ahead. Question from Rasik Shah. Rasik, can you unmute yourself and ask the question? I'll unmute you then. Rasik, are you there?
Yeah, no question as of now. Please go ahead.
Okay, great. Okay, somebody else? Anybody else want a question?
Yes, I have a question. Hello?
Yeah, please go ahead.
Yeah, Vinay.
Yeah. Yeah, my question is that what can be done at the level of entrepreneur? The balance of payment situation with respect to China or to attract investment from or to divert investment from China, because a lot of countries are looking for alternative market for manufacturing and for other activities. What should be done at the private entrepreneur level?
So the message was loud and clear that we are running a huge current account deficit with China. So the message was clear that we are not importing petroleum product from China. We are only possibly most of the items are consumables. Possibly we can also importing some of the capital items. So if you leave behind the capital items, I personally believe that it is my analysis, I may be wrong, that we can also manufacture those items in India. So this is also easier said than done. We have also got a debate on this thing that just manufacturing on a large scale, you don't need only capital, you need to create the infrastructure. But unfortunately, that infrastructure needs to be built up, because if you want to bring a large entity, for example, I easily remember POSCO has come to India around 20 years back, and they could not set up their base. They were trying to set up their base in Orissa. They could not set up their base of a steel plant. So because of the reason that there are a lot of issues regarding approvals, bureaucracy, and various things. So I easily remember China has a very simplified concept of giving licenses to manufacturing entities to increase their sales in export. And they were very, very successful. But unfortunately, we are hit by the bureaucratic approach in setting up the manufacturing bases in India. I may be wrong. This is my assessment.
My question is that, you see, we cannot do much about how government functions. So my question is that, can we do an analysis of what are the items of import and then create an awareness in the Indian business community about things which can be done in India? Something, I think we need to move beyond what the government can do. No. And at our level, if we can do something.
Vinay, I will disagree with you here. I disagree with you here. Because for example, that the item which we are importing from China is $75 billion, which is not a small amount. If you are trying to set up a factory for $75 billion in India, you need to do the overhauling of your entire system. Under this system, you can't put the manufacturing base in India for $75 billion. You can't do it actually. Because you need to create infrastructure for that thing. That is the reason that it is easier said than done actually. That is the statement which I have made. So just putting a remark that you want create a replacement for China, just by saying these words, it is not easy. You need to create infrastructure.
Shrini, I think you made your point. There are lots of other questions coming up. Vinay, good point. We can take that offline as well. Sangeeta, please go ahead. You have a question.
Yeah, I have a question, Srini, on your last slide where you're showing that comparison between US, China and India, the qualitative factors.
Yeah.
Over there, I just want to understand that workforce skill sets. You know, China is showing over there at 64th. Yeah. I mean, is that true? I mean, what kind of parameters go into this, if you could just explain a little bit?
Shagun, are you there on the call? Shagun?
Yeah, I will have to unmute him actually. Or you can unmute yourself, Shagun, if you are there.
I am on the call.
So, yeah. Shagun, can you answer this thing that what are the parameters which are being considered in the workforce skill set? If those are ready with you?
Yes, just give me a second. So, let me tell you, when we talk about the numbers, so the reason I put the ranking and the scores over here is First of all, these are publicly available numbers provided by WEF. So we are not putting our own, our own understanding of what would the numbers be. For example, everybody will have a different view of what the numbers would be as compared to US, China, India would have a greater number. Yes. But here the workforce skill set is taken in around the whole, nutshell. The parameters I would like to explain over here taken is the current workforce. It takes in factors, the base parameters like what is the mean years of schooling done, what could have been the skill set generated by the individual during the schooling on the basis of years of schooling done, then this extent of training provided by the employer to the staff, the quality of vocational training. Here is where the China has a very good upward trend, because although we say that the educational qualification towards IT is far more better, but on the global perspective, not through Indian perspective, from the global perspective, the vocational training is much higher in the China. And of course, these are the points which will always be debatable. But just to bring out the global perspective, we have taken numbers from WEF.
No, that's okay. I actually was this thing because it is showing 64th for China, when we all know that, you know, they are a hardworking community, enterprising, you know, there are good factors which work in China's favor. So I was surprised to see that it is ranked as 64th in this particular chart.
Yes, the one of the reason is, see, we see China at a very high skill set in terms of manufacturing. But when we talk about in the global perspective where IT industry has been trading here in their services, there is where the China is lacking.
Just put the parameters. Sangeeta also just want to know that what are the parameters?
Yes.
The current workforce includes the extent of staff training, quality of vocational training, skill sets of the graduates which come out from the college, and these have been rated by the huge number of people on the surveys, and digital skills among active population, ease of finding skilled employees. The future workforce talks about the education.
I think Shagun, sorry to interject, but I think you have directionally mentioned how it has been done. You can share the details with Sangeeta separately if you can, please. Let's move to the next question.
Thank you, Rakesh.
Yeah. Raviji, over to you.
Yeah. I want to ask a question. Like, something is bothering me for last 2 months, that the rating of China. China has been a communist country, and how the rating agencies have given them A and AA rating when today China has taken the whole world by ransom. And even earlier, no communist country ever in the world, be it Russia or Eastern Bloc, has ever produced an efficient economy. Still, we keep on rating these countries. When we talk of political risk of our country, why don't we talk about the opaqueness of China's politics? I mean, the communist country can never produce any efficient economy. So why we have, I think rating agencies themselves have failed in rating China. I want your comment on this.
Raviji, I wanted to hear your voice because you are involved in the philanthropic activities. So my wish of hearing to you is fulfilled. So this is just one of the comments. And let me address you this point, that why China's rating are far, far superior. So as I mentioned to you, that there are quantitative parameters and there are qualitative parameters. So if you are leaving behind the qualitative parameters for the time being, then let me tell you that on all quantitative parameters, China is far superior than India. On any parameter, you take any parameter, whatever we have presented to you right now, you go through that presentation, all parameters, they are far superior than India. Far, far superior. I completely agree with you that there is no transparency, there is no disclosure. There is a lot of military kind of regime which is prevalent in their country. But even after discounting those things, they are financially stable. Their financial balance sheet is very good. Very good. They have managed their financial balance sheet very well in last 10, 15 years. Very well.
Thanks, Shri. Any more questions from anybody? So, Shri, I had a question, you know, and again, this is a concern that I think most of us have. You know, the impact of COVID, you know, we understood in a very interesting manner how does our P&L and balance sheet look like. This is what was in a situation when we had normal days. In a scenario where we are probably experiencing the worst ever crisis in our history, how do you think this balance sheet would look like in 2021? And how will it impact our rating, our overall, you know, well-being?
So, Rakesh, the question which you have raised is for an economist. I'm not an economist, actually. So, I'm not an economist which can address this thing. But I would say that, let me only talk about the parameter which I have covered. The fiscal deficit will be definitely higher.
No, I wanted to ask you one from a rating perspective, because you talked about rating, that how... I'm trying to ask you, how will it impact our rating? We're already at BBB. And if we go down, because that is one of the biggest concerns that we have. That is number one. End of the day, if my revenues are short, I mean, if you look at April GST collection is significantly down. We are at about only 26,000 crores vis-a-vis about a lakh that we normally have. So we are down 75% in terms of revenue. So that will obviously lead to a larger fiscal deficit. We are already talking about anything between 6.5% to 7%. Now, all of this will have an impact on our rating, right? So how do you see that scenario playing out? Because as the economy activity is being shut, and if it continues to be shut like this, I think we are facing a huge disaster in front of us.
So I completely agree with you that, as I mentioned to you, that let us only talk about three parameters: your rupee balance sheet, your foreign currency balance sheet, and your qualitative parameters. So qualitative parameter, there will not be any change, because those will remain constant during crisis, post-crisis, pre-crisis period. Your foreign currency is very strong as of right now. We are maintaining good balances. We have got 450 billion of reserve, can take care of import, which can take, and we have got advantage on foreign currency balance sheet because crude prices are lower and there is no demand actually. There's no demand of crude actually. So we are fairly stable on foreign currency balance sheet. The only problem, only problem which we will be facing is primarily our fiscal deficit and gross debt to the GDP ratio. If our fiscal deficit is increasing 10%, then those 10% will be primarily being transferred to your gross debt actually. So the gross debt is 70%, that can increase to 80% actually. That is the way it is looked to be seen. So from 70 to 80% is a big jump actually. It's a very, very big jump. It's a very big jump. So rating agency has got liberty to downgrade. There is no, I have no concession on this statement that rating agency can downgrade us. But there is also a human factor that we are going through a crisis period. Possibly they allow us some time to recover actually. They have given liberty to some European countries also. Possibly they can also give some liberty to us. This is my personal statement.
I understand you directionally, I wanted to understand.
So Sriram here, if I may just add, you know, with your kind permission. Yeah. See, one of the things with ratings is always a relative scale. Okay, US's fiscal deficit after their concessions that they've already given and the ones that they're going to give being an election year, it is likely that US fiscal deficit will hit 18% to 20% of their GDP. So the first question is that will they downgrade the US? Obviously not. Okay. So S&P has done, but Moody's haven't. Okay. So similarly, most of Europe, Germany, France, Italy, Spain, I mean, all of them are in on a deep trouble. And there, if one goes by conventional rating parameters, okay, most of these guys will really look down the barrel. So I personally would think that there will not be any significant rating action for the next 6 months to a year. There'll be a lot of caution thrown. There'll be a lot of, you know, negative outlook put out. But I don't expect, because nobody knows the form of capital flows that is going to happen, a host of things. I mean, we are looking at probably a once in a millennium event. So therefore, I personally feel that rating agencies will hit the pause button for now. They probably will, you know, though if you really are profligate, probably you will get hit sometimes. But otherwise, I personally feel there'll be no action by rating agencies for a while, at least 6 months to 9 months. They will kind of reassess where it all goes, actually. That's my view, because the fiscal deficit scale is going to be high for everybody.
So Rakesh, Sriram was my boss actually in ICRA, and so I have no comments to make.
we were colleagues.
I have no comments against Sriram.
But can I speak?
Yeah.
You know, Japan has a debt to GDP of 225 with an average age which is much, much higher, about more than 65 years. So they have not downgraded Japan, and we have an average age of 26, and if 10% jump in debt, if it is used for creating infrastructure for bringing in manufacturing facilities, I don't think so there will be a downgrade.
रवि जी, मैं आपके क्वेश्चन का ऐसा आंसर देना चाहता हूं कि ये जो मैंने स्लाइड अभी जो दिखा रहा हूं आपको, यू नीड टू अंडरस्टैंड दिस स्लाइड एक्चुअली. दिस स्लाइड इज शोइंग दैट यू आर ओनली टेकिंग टू पैरामीटर्स. पैरामीटर इज एक्सटर्नल, सॉरी, डेट टू जीडीपी, एंड यू आर टेकिंग अबाउट द एजिंग पॉपुलेशन. बट यू नीड टू सी दैट देर आर नॉट टू पैरामीटर्स विच आर गोइंग इन टू द रेटिंग ऑफ एन ऑफ ए सोवरेन एंटिटी. देर आर हंड्रेड ऑफ पैरामीटर्स. So on 100 parameters, you are rating that country that, and let me tell you that rating exercise is not a couple of week exercise. It's a couple of month exercise. If you look at this slide, which I'm showing it to you right now, then you will understand it is just a plotting the numbers and take out the results from the Excel sheet. No, it is not that. Let me say one experience with me. I had been to Nigeria in 2019 actually. So fortunately, I have been exposed to some rating rationale which I have received there. You trust me that they have given two notch up to Nigeria only because of one single reason, that they have got good trade agreements with their neighboring countries. Two notch up only on single thing. They have been given single B kind of rating. I don't remember their rating as of right now. They are single B, but they have given double B minus kind of thing to that country just because the single reason that they have got good trade agreement that will increase their GDP share. They can increase their GDP size, that can move them towards prosperity kind of thing. So rating is not, that is the, if you see that my very first comment before starting this presentation, that there are a lot of discussion which is happening in the in our group, that our inflation is 4%, our GDP ratio is one of the highest, GDP growth is one of the highest, so on so forth kind of thing. But rating is not dependent upon 4 parameters or 10 parameters. Rating is not dependent on few parameters which we are discussing in our group. Rating is dependent on various parameters, and that is the reason for making this presentation. That is the only reason. That let me educate the group members that rating exercise is an extensive exercise. It goes in number of quarters actually. Number of quarters. One quarter, two quarter. If they are not satisfied, they are not disclosing the rating also. They are not getting information kind of thing.
Okay.
Hello.
Raviji, we have other.
Okay, sorry.
Please, so, Rakesh, can I ask a question?
Yeah, please, Rajesh. Please go ahead. Thank you.
Okay. Well, when we are talking about 80% GDP, borrowing to GDP ratio, what sort of interest rate regime we are looking forward in the coming years?
Rajeshji, I think my boss Sriram has already addressed. Let me also address that. To just bring the current cost is primarily 8% as of right now. 8% as of right. The average cost is 8%. It has been issued long back. This is not my number. This is RBI annual report, 18-19 report, which has disclosing that 8% is average coupon on outstanding borrowing as of right now. So this has been issued long back, 5 years back, 7 years back. Those are mature. They will mature in next 7 years, 8 years, 10 years kind of thing. So what is happening that we have issued those long-term debts in past, And unfortunately, that legacy is still being continued. Current rate is 6.5%, but we are still paying 1.5% higher. So the impact will come down. And impact will come down further when those debts will be replaced by the new debt, which has got 6% and 6.5%. And that will be further down 6% once we control the inflation, because inflation and interest rate has got direct linkages actually.
But when we are talking about that inflation is going to go up in the current scenario, so do we believe that the interest rate will still come down?
No, then it will not come down. Because, let us understand that when we are rating agencies are looking into the parameters, they are not looking at the 1 year scenario. They will always exclude the spikes in your rates actually. They will tell that no, these are stressful conditions, let us not consider it actually.
Okay.
There are always human judgment. I'm telling you, when they are coming out with the score, they will always look into those numbers there. They will apply the human judgment. This is not a machine related Excel sheet kind of scenario where that whatever coming out of the Excel sheet, they will also look into that thing. That is one of the things. They have gone through the stressful period and the world has global, at the global level, the problem was there. So let us discount that thing. But okay, if that is perennial for next 5 years, we are 7%, 8% kind of thing, that will not be discounted. Okay. If it is only for a year, they will definitely discount actually.
Okay, thanks for the insight. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Rene. Thank you so much. Guys, one last question. If anybody wants to ask one last question.
Anshul this side. Can I ask something?
Yeah, Anshul, please go ahead. Yeah.
Hello, sir. Sir, my question was on the state borrowing. So the PNL number which you shared, both in terms of the borrowing by the government and the interest cost, does that include the external borrowings and the internal borrowings by the state governments? And if it doesn't, then what could be the figure of, what could the size of that figure, and is it a further strain on the entire situation that we have discussed? Further strain on the rating possibility?
No, I think that let me tell you that the 70 or 80% debt to GDP ratio which I'm talking about right now, that includes the state debts also, state government borrowings also. So the central government borrowing to GDP is something around 45% and 25% is the state. So when we are looking about the balance sheet of India, then the balance sheet of India includes the net borrowing of a state. Net borrowing of a state is primarily because center is also giving some fund to the state. So that is being netted off. So primarily the borrowing as of right now is 70%, 45% is government borrowing, and 25% to GDP is the state borrowing. So that is the way the 70% is being constituted in the analysis. Now coming to the interest rate, I will come back to you, but as of right now, I think that the interest number which is on the slide as of right now, this is only for the central government, because this is central government revenue and expenditure. This is not state government numbers are not being here. I will come back to you that why this is only central government, why state numbers are not being coming into you. Let me do some research and come back to you on this.
Thanks. Thanks, Rini. Last one question that has come through a message from Vedula, and she's in a noisy place and hence she couldn't ask this question to you. Is there no impact of the state financials on the sovereign rating of the country, despite a large part of the revenue being from the states?
That's so, Rakesh, let me answer you this thing, that state governments, when they are looking at the fiscal strength of the country, then they also look at the fiscal strength of state also. But mainly they look at the center, because center is primarily very powerful in our country. So they also look into the state government. And fortunately, state governments are not into very deep problem kind of thing. They are not running 10-12% deficit. If I am not wrong, I will come back to you that those numbers are also in the 3-4%. This is on the back of my mind. I will also confirm that number. So state government deficit is also in the 3-4% or 4-5% range. So which is similar to the central government deficit. So that is not... the numbers are not in the in a very red zone area kind of thing, that 15% or 20% kind of thing. So rating agencies is also considering the state government health when they are taking into consideration, but the higher weightages are being given to the central government financial health actually.
Thanks. Thanks a ton.
If I may add to, you are right. That's what I'm saying. The FRBM Act, which has been promulgated, which is the Fiscal Responsibility and Budget Management Act, is incumbent on state governments not to cross the 3% fiscal deficit. But I mean, some of them are slightly above, maybe 3.5, but everybody is below 4. You cannot, there's no runaway deficit allowed. Point number one. Point number two is state borrowings as a percentage of state GDP is limited to 27%. Between 27 and 30 is where the limit is. You cannot borrow beyond that. States are not allowed to borrow beyond that because all state government borrowings are through RBI. RBI issues SDLs. So RBI will not allow you to borrow if you cross that threshold. So these two have helped keep the state government deficits, which was as high as 10-12% earlier, to around less than 4%. So the overall deficit of 3.84 is where, you know, the country would.
Thanks, sir. Thanks a lot, Srini. So, guys, thank you so much. And with this, we come to the end of this session. I think it was amazing. We learned a lot. And Srini, thank you so much. And it was an initiative that came actually from Srini, and he approached me to say that he would get his entire team to speak to all of us. So, thank you so much for that, guys. You know, during this lockdown, and you know, obviously everybody is trying to do a lot of stuff. This is also one thing, this entire knowledge series that we've started will continue with this. So we will try to have at least one session every week. So please come with your suggestions, if any. If somebody wants to take volunteer to do a session, please, you're most welcome to do it. Or if you have colleagues, you know somebody whom you think we should listen to, more than happy to do that. So you can write to me or you can write to Pankaj, any one of us. That will be really great. So with these words, guys, thank you so much. Have a nice weekend. Stay safe. Stay care. We'll see you soon. Thank you. Bye.
Thanks a lot.